Hey everybody, today we have the pleasure to introduce a very good friend of mine and the head coach for University of South Florida, Coach Matt Hill. Matt, thank you very much for being with us today.
I
really appreciate your time and effort. And first of all, congratulations on a tremendous season.
You guys did
an unbelievable job finishing top 16. You know, a lot of the coaches in Egypt really would like to hear the story behind it. You know, a couple of years ago, the team was maybe, you know, outside the top 60. And in a couple of years, you moved that team from that position into an elite position in the top 16. What's your take? How do you feel?
It's been good. Obviously, we're really excited about kind of where the program is going. Like Tamer said, we started off around 74 in the country when we took the position over, and just kind of try to turn it into more of a professional program, a program that players that are wanting to use the college system as a platform to move from juniors to the professional tour. That was really our goal from day one. So we had to make some changes with the personnel, the players that we had, and then we had to make some changes as well with who we were recruiting and the way and the culture and the training that we had. So
I'm sure you know with the recruiting it's entirely different when you have when you're at 74 in the nation and you're looking to recruit some players, or let's say for example for next season when you're top 16, because I guess the demands right now for the competition and to move up to the top four is a lot higher. So what's your take on this? Like what kind of players will you be looking at for the future to move the program forward?
Yeah, for us, I mean, now really to move from a 10 to 15 range into a top, like you said, top five range, it's really about recruiting players that are playing in the Grand Slams or the junior events, so typically top 50 ITF, or players that are, you know, top 1,000 ATP, and kind of doing well in future main draw. Those are the players that you see at that level.
Sure, and anybody outside that framework might add a little bit of depth to the team, but might not contribute at that level. So we can safely say that the top five schools, you know, and the NCAAs produce pretty good professional athletes.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you're seeing a lot of pro tennis players come out of those ranks. I mean, you have multiple in the top 100, but then you've got, if you look from 100 to 200 ATP, there's just tons of ex-college guys. There's a lot.
Okay, I mean, you know, a lot of the coaches in Egypt that are going to be watching this want to know what they can do. Like, let's say I have a kid who's 12 or 13 years old, and I want him to, you know, to move forward. What steps would you advise us to take? Like, what are the necessary things that we should do for a young athlete? And how about an athlete who's, let's say, maybe 16 years old and has only, like, 1 year left? What should we do?
I think there's multiple steps you can take, obviously. If they're ranked high enough to where they can play Eddie Herr and Orange Bowl, that's a great opportunity to get over to the United States to play on a big international stage, and all the coaches are always there. So those are great events that we've seen some of the top Egyptians at over the past few years come to, and that's a real healthy environment for us. The other thing is, if you're not maybe that highly ranked ITF-wise, but you're one of the top juniors in all of Egypt, just getting your name out there and your video out there, and when I say video, we typically, I personally like to see a video of you playing a match rather than necessarily a video of just a few strokes.
And there's going to be a lot of, like, Steven Spielberg edit the video, make sure that it looks great.
Yeah. So we love to see, personally, we love to see competitive matches. If you're one of the top Egyptian players in the country and you're playing the national championships or even a regional championship against another elite junior from your country, those are great matches to videotape and to get us footage of. That we love to see that.
So. And how about if a coach, you know, starts, I don't want to say pressuring, but maybe they send you the national rank. How much weight does a coach in your position, like, let's say, you know, and you can be as honest as you can.
Yeah, no.
We want to teach our coaches, you know, what to look for. Does the Egyptian national ranking have a lot of weight in your decision?
I'm not that familiar with the Egyptian national rankings, to be honest. I've always I've always known the top couple Egyptian players are exceptional players and could easily play on a top team in college. Okay. So, but from our standpoint, obviously, trying to make a push to be one of those top five programs, you really have to be probably one of the best players in your country, not just in Egypt, but all around the world, you know, with the exception of maybe some of the powerhouse countries like France or Spain or Germany or something like that. But yeah, I mean, for college tennis in general, it can play a factor, but it's difficult for us to determine the player's level based on the Egyptian national rankings because, you know, we're not in that country. We're not seeing what does 10 in the country in Egypt mean. Yeah, we don't know that.
What's
the UTR rankings are a good way sometimes that it's that universal tennis rating system that typically will work really well.
Okay, now you know you do take into some you know perspective if it was like a German or a French ranking system because it maybe has you know more depth into it and you can verify a little bit more because a lot of those players are also ranked internationally, so you
of
can
course.
Kind of measure
understand,
and see.
Understand, yes.
Okay, so we're hoping that, you know, with all the, you know, what we're trying to do, the effort is getting the Egyptian ranking system and the Egyptian players towards that, to where our ranking system is verified as well.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of what we do over the past few days with the coaches is going to be based on physical fitness.
Yes, sir.
How much did that play a factor in moving the team from where it was to where it is? And feel free to go into details. I mean, what cycles did you guys go through, and how hard did the guys, and what about the relationship? You have 6-7 guys from different parts of the world that have to come together to a certain goal, and thus suffering through fitness health and all these things. So what's your take on it?
Yeah, no, I mean, fitness is obviously, as the game has evolved over the past, 10-20 years, you can tell that fitness is one of the key components that has changed due to the technology of the rackets and just the athletes being more professional about being athletes, you know? I mean, you look at Djokovic, the way he's treating nutrition nowadays is changing the ways people look at it. Just the fitness side of things, apart from Lendl and some of those guys, there wasn't a lot of that going on, and now it's just common practice. You see a whole team around people, and it's the same for us. When we took over the program, our guys had no understanding of nutrition. They had no regular fitness regimen. I mean, I went down to the strength staff and I said, hey, when are we working out with, who's my coach? And they were like, oh, well, it's been optional. Well, that, you know, that's just not gonna cut it. Now we're on 6 days. You know, typically the way it cycles for us, because we're a spring sport, we play our team matches. Our main part of the season is towards the end of spring. So we wanna be playing our best tennis in April and May. That's key for us. So that's when we really look to peak. We spend the fall as really a developmental time, training block time, where we're really in the gym a lot more than we are necessarily on the court doing speed, agility, that kind of stuff. We're doing a lot of strength work in the gym. So that's where if somebody comes in and they're 10-15 pounds less than we'd like them in terms of muscle mass, we're really like pushing it in the fall.
So body fat percentage and muscle mass is a big deal.
Yeah,
in other words, you know, training the athlete, there's certain, you have goals that you set in the beginning of the fall,
or is
it, you know, do you set these goals or does the physical trainer?
So as a staff, we have a coaching staff of 3, we have a strength staff of 2, and then we have a physio staff of 2 main people, but you know, Steve Wells and those guys are kind of directors.
It's a team that's handling it.
Yeah, there's a team around it, and one of the first things we do with all our athletes, new and old, every time they come in each semester is they go through a pre-screening exam. And so that pre-screening exam goes through any like muscle imbalances, all the like scap tests, all the internal, external rotation stuff, just to see where they're at from a muscle imbalance standpoint. And if there's any areas that we need to put into a prehab program, not a rehab program, but a prehab program, to make sure we don't get them injured in the gym.
Yeah.
And then we evaluate them really as coaches. The coaching staff, tennis coaching staff, evaluates them in terms of a lot of the weight, body fat, things like that, and then we test them for that, And then yes, we put goals together. The coaching staff will direct that and inform the strength staff and the physio staff, hey, this is what we're doing. This guy's at 155, he needs to be at 170. We need to put him on a protein program. You know, he needs to be this extra in the gym on top of what the team is doing as a whole.
Yeah.
And so
there is the individual part from the team. Right?
Yes.
I mean, like, some guys are going to need to be in the gym a little
100%.
Bit more than others.
Yeah.
Because one thing that we're big, you know, in trying to explain is that every player has his own platform.
Yeah.
Positives and negatives and weaknesses and strength. But if you were to put a percentage between, and we'll break it into two because there's a lot of components, like the mental component, the strategic component. But if we're talking about the tennis component and the fitness component only.
Okay.
Only. As the level goes up, let's say, what is the breakdown of work, percentage-wise? Like, let's say an athlete who's playing top for USF right now.
Yeah.
How much physical work is the focus on compared to the tennis?
40-50%.
So half their work is pretty much physical.
Yeah.
Yeah, because technically, if you don't get to the ball, then it doesn't matter how.
Yeah, I mean, and that's the thing that you're finding is coaches started demanding more out of these athletes because they saw the game evolving,
yeah.
And then they started to figure out, like, well, if we don't address flexibility, if we don't address speed or movement patterns, like technical movement patterns and how they move to the ball to get there quicker, they physically can't do what these other pros are doing.
Yeah.
So, like you said,
you got to be handling the weight.
Yeah, I mean, you have to be able to handle the weight. You have to be able to get to the ball, because if you're not to the ball with time, there's only so much you can do. Whereas if you are there with time, you can do
options.
X, Y, and Z. You have more options. So, it's one of the areas of the game that if you don't have this piece, you can't get to the top without that.
So you
piece.
can have, you know, one area in your tennis that could be a little weaker than the rest and still survive.
Yeah.
But you cannot have any area in your physique or your physical fitness and survive.
I don't think so, because it's directly tied to your mental aspect. Yeah. You know, and we all know this as players. When you played, if you were strong physically, your mind was generally pretty strong.
That's correct. Yes.
You know.
Yes.
Whereas if you're not physically fit, if you don't believe you put the time in or you haven't put the time in and you can't last in that third set when it actually, I mean, who cares about the first and second if you can't win the third?
That's correct. Yes.
And so your mind just deteriorates because of your fitness, and it is one of the few areas that you can actually control prior to stepping on the court.
Yeah.
So
no, I agree 100%, and you know, I know all the coaches know it, but the only thing is, you know, also I am sure that you have developed a very strong personal relationship with those players, because you're going to be asking them to push further than they've ever pushed before.
Yes.
So I, you know, don't you agree that also the coach has a responsibility to develop that, you know, that relationship with the player, since the player is the younger individual in the equation?
Yeah, I think I think in our aspects of sport in general, if you don't have if the relationship, the player to coach relationship isn't founded on trust, you're going to have a real difficult time getting through to that player when you're trying to give information. And like you said, in terms of a fitness component, and this is the gap between the juniors and the pros right now, is that fitness component. They're not able to turn at 18.
Faster and strong.
Yeah, it's faster and stronger, and some of them aren't physically mature enough to do it yet. So there's a gap, but that's causing all these problems because Federation stopped funding at 18, and they used to break through at 18, and now it's 21, and so there's a gap there. And this is the gap that we're talking about. But yeah, you're absolutely right. If you're going to have to push them physically harder than what junior tennis demands of them.
Yeah.
And
so
they
always say the word demands.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming that you feel that it's out of necessity. So,
yeah.
You know, if the, you know, to get them to the pros, it is necessary to get to that level that you're talking about of fitness.
Yeah, absolutely. Because if you don't, you're not training these players to become 20 in the world in juniors. Nobody cares about that. They care about 20 in the world as a pro. So that,
yeah.
In my vision as a coach, I'm always training them as I see them in my mind long term.
You have a vision that you're following.
Absolutely. And you have to demand that from them on a day-to-day, minute-to-minute, hourly basis, or they're not going to they're not going to get there, you know.
No, and, so. And I, you know, it's obvious from the results, you know, how much of a great job you guys has done, you personally, of course, wow. as a team. You know, I've been personally at USF for so many years. It's great for us and the community to see this happening next doors, for my young players to come and watch these, you know, these college players perform at that level, helps everybody in the area. So, you know, tremendous achievement. Congratulations to USF.
Wow, thank you.
One last question before we go, because I know they're going to ask me about this.
Yeah.
The new technologies that's coming in the rehab, we're all hearing about, you know, oxygen chambers. We're hearing about ice bath.
Oh, yeah.
We're hearing about heart rate monitors.
Yeah.
Can you briefly just touch base on each one of those really quick?
Yeah, absolutely. The oxygen chambers, I don't have a lot of experience with. I know the LTA started using them a lot, and I know a lot of the Olympic athletes use those a lot to recover quicker. They're really expensive, so that's one area we actually don't have at USF. The ice bath. Our guys use the ice bath after every training session.
Every day?
Every training session.
Okay,
so when they get done with training, they go to the ice bath, because the reality is, you know, we have this saying that's in our culture that train how you compete, train how you compete, train how you compete. And if they're training, if they're truly training as hard as they are when they're competing, they have to get into the ice bath. They have to do the recovery program properly in order to come back the next day and do it again. So that is something we do every day.
So there's a lot of work that goes into rehabilitation to be able to work and train at the same level that you guys are competing at all the time.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I mean by it. You have to be a professional. You really have to be a professional with the way you treat your body and the way you eat. And these areas are paramount into you reaching that next level.
Yeah.
So,
which is very hard.
Which is hard, you know, but you give yourself the best chance possible, and you hope you make it. And so the ice bath, we do that on a regular basis.
How about the heart rate monitor?
The heart rate monitor, we do that with the fitness staff, the strength staff, to give us baselines.
So basically, it's not on a daily basis. This is like a monitor kind of deal. It's like an exercise.
Yeah. Now, if we have the extra time and the support staff around, and we're like, do it every day, I think we would try to utilize it, because it's a great barometer on where your player is in terms of pushing themselves. I think as a coach,
it tells you their range,
right?
Whether they're really going to up to the range or they're taking it a time.
Right. And I think as a coach, we use it as a baseline, and then the coach, when you're a coach and you really know your players, you should kind of know that level without even having
you
to look at a watch.
Having the tech, yeah. The watch, yeah.
Exactly. So, but it is a good for some of those guys that don't. You know, they don't understand where their 100% is. I think that's very common when we get new.
Show them you still got left in the tank.
Right. When we bring in new players from the juniors, they have no idea where their 100% is, what their max is. So doing that and the VO2 max testing and the things like that, where they're really having to.
The VO2 max is when you get hooked up to the computer.
You like basically have to stop.
Yeah.
So that's a good way to test kind of where they're at as well.
So is it safe to say, I mean, just to put a little bit of light on the procedure, is that everything is evaluated at the beginning, and that's how you keep track. It's not just by feel, correct?
You have to know where you're starting to know where you want to go and where you want to end up, and so.
Yeah, because I mean, you know, part of the discussion that we have in Egypt right now is how to quantify what's, you know, how the progress is going to be. Because it also, you know, from a teaching perspective for younger coaches, it helps with the parents.
Yeah,
because they always like, you know, like, well, he's getting worse, he's getting better.
Yeah.
But when you have times for runs, times for weights that are going up now that haven't been going up, then, you know, automatically, then we're definitely in the right direction.
You can, anytime you can quantify anything, in my opinion, it's a good thing. Because from a player standpoint, they're motivated when they see
small success.
We take pictures, like shirts off, take pictures before and after shots. Every couple months.
Yeah.
Because they, you know, when you look at your body and you're working out, it's hard work. Yeah, it's hard work for that. So I mean, we take pictures, everything for the athlete to see the transformation, as well as, you know, parents when you're talking about young players.
Yeah.
But yeah, anytime I think you can quantify something and show improvement in another way, even trying to do that even on the tennis court, yeah, it's been going well. You know.
Matt, I mean, I can't thank you enough.
Yeah, for sure.
It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, I'm sure
all these coaches are gonna benefit a lot from that, and USF guys, okay?
Yeah.
So hopefully we'll get some of these youngsters to come and play for the Bulls.
Yeah, and anything we can do, whatever helps, Tamara has our contact information. So.
And we're waiting for you in Egypt sometime.
Yeah,
Matt, appreciate it.
Thank you guys.
I think it's good, huh?
Yeah, it's good.
Is there anything else you wanted to add?
No, I thought that was really good.